So anyway, so this time is the turn of Paolo, that he will talk about the role of the neutrino oscillation in some cosmological scenarios.
I think it's in many questions.
Okay. Thank you, Roberto.
So, yes, I'm going to talk about the role of neutrino oscillations in a couple of cosmological scenarios. But before that, since I'm going to speak about neutrinos and about neutrino oscillations, let me go to a brief introduction. I'm not going to go into historical details and so on. I'm going only to say that for me, and I guess for some of you, neutrinos are one of the most interesting particles that have been ever detected. And the reason is simple. They've been always in the middle of some problem, either as part of the solution or as part of the problem itself. They've been as a part of a problem. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples for that. The first one is their own postulation. When they were postulated, as a solution for a problem found in the beta decay spectrum. They expected that at that time, that beta decay happened going into a nucleus and also to the charged electron. So they could measure the energy of the charged electron, and if the process was only going to two particles, they expected that energy to be unique, to be a peak. But they found this, which is clearly not a peak. So in 1930, Pauli came with a solution, and he thought that this behavior could be done because instead of going to two particles, the beta decay could happen going to three particles, one of them that wasn't detected and carried part of the energy. And that was the reason. But this particle was so weakly interacting that it took almost 30 years from the hypothesis to the first detection, carried by Cowen and Rains in 1956. So they detected for first time neutrinos, and they started building new detectors and detecting more and more neutrinos. Not so much, but it was enough. And they found another problem. They found that from the solar models that they had, they expected a number of neutrinos coming to the Earth that was not the number of neutrinos that they measured. So they measured a lot of less neutrinos than expected. And they discovered that the way of obtaining the right amount of neutrinos was summing up every flavor. They expected only, in principle, the electron neutrinos, but they measured electron, muon, and tau neutrinos. So summing the three flavors of neutrinos, they could explain the expected number of neutrinos produced in the sun. So something was happening there, that even though a neutrino could be produced as electron type, when you go and try to detect it, you could detect it as another flavor. And the solution for this problem was the fact that neutrinos oscillate in flavor, which was determined by Campbell. So, what is neutrino oscillations? Neutrino oscillations is the fact that even though they can be produced with a given weak eigenstate, these states are not the true eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. So they are a mixture of the true eigenstate that propagate, and since these eigenstates have different masses, they propagate differently. So in the end, the mixture changes along the propagation, and you can detect a different flavor than the one that was originally produced. So neutrino oscillations means that neutrinos are massive and mixed. So the flavor neutrinos are a mixture of the massive neutrinos, and initially the mixing matrix is parameterized in this way, where C and S are cosine and sine of angles, so there are three mixing angles and a phase. So, having all of this said, let me go to what I'm going to speak about. So, I will use this to try to explain you why neutrinos and their oscillations are important in a couple of things. In determining the effective number of neutrinos, which is a parameter of the standard cosmological model that accounts for any contribution to radiation different from photons, and in setting a lower bound for the reheating temperature of the universe. Let me go to the first topic. This part of the talk is going to be based on a work with my advisor, Sergio Pastor. And to put some context on it, let me remind you that nowadays we are living in a universe which is dominated with something that we don't know, and we call dark energy, which is responsible for the accelerated expansion of the universe. But this was not the case before. So in early stages of the universe, it was dominated by matter, and even earlier, by radiation. Here, matter is in form of baryons and dark matter, and radiation, I consider it in form of photons and massless neutrinos, just for simplicity in this plot. So this could be the time direction, going in this direction. So as I'm going to speak about a parameter which is important in the radiation dominated epoch of the universe, I'm going to see here. And in this time, the typical chart pi, which appears with the 68% of dark energy and 30 something of matter, would take this form, which everything is in form of radiation. Here, again, in form of photons and neutrinos. So the energy density of the universe in this time is the energy density of radiation, so the sum of the contribution of photons and neutrinos. And it could, there can be also a contribution coming from some particles that were that behave like relativistic at this time. And the effective number of neutrinos, since it's a parameter that accounts for the contribution to radiation different from photons, is going to give us information about how much room there's left for this possibility. So let me now introduce to you the two processes that are going to be important along this part of the talk related with the computation of NFT. They are the neutrino decoupling and the electron-positron annihilation. When the universe was radiation-dominated, there was a time in which the temperature that was going down because of the expansion reached a value of order MeV. And then the weak interactions started to be less effective than the expansion of the universe. So neutrinos decoupled from the rest of the cosmic plasma. They stopped speaking with the rest of the particles, and they kept going on their own. And before that, after that, when the temperature went down to below the mass of the electron, this reaction, that at higher temperatures could happen in both directions, started to happen just in this direction. So electrons and positrons started to annihilate into photons. If we consider the case in which neutrinos decoupled instantaneously, then they were already decoupled when this process happened, and therefore, since the temperature of neutrinos was evolving just because of the expansion, but photons were reheated because of this annihilation, we can compute the difference, the fraction of the two temperatures, and we would obtain this number. But this is an approximation, and we're going to see that this is important to relax this approximation.
Sorry, I have a question. I understand that this one-third power comes because in the radiation-dominated era, the expansion is proportional to T cube, right? And is there a way to naively understand this 4/11 fraction? Like, why this is? What is
this?
It depends on this. I don't know.
It depends on the different particles that were relativistic before the annihilations and then after the annihilations. So you count the degree of freedoms, and counting them and computing with them, you can obtain this just by conservation of entropy, for example.
Yeah, that 11 depend on this effective number of neutrinos? Like this fraction depend on this effective number of neutrinos that you...
No, the effective number of neutrinos is going to depend on this fraction. Okay. you're going to see later that the definition of the effective number of neutrinos is based in principle on this. Okay. But since it's not going to be exactly this value, then the parameter changes. But you could have defined the effective number of neutrinos with the truly ratio, and then you would have obtained a different number, a parameter. Okay. Well, let me go to that. I think it's going to be better. So what is the effective number of neutrinos? This is the definition written in this way. But for those that prefer words, as I already said, an effective is a parameter that accounts for any contribution to radiation different from photons. And if you want to understand better why this definition, let's go back a couple of steps. So this is the radiation energy density of the universe, which is the energy density of the universe at that time, in form of photons, neutrinos, and whatever else. And we also know that we can relate the energy density of a species of neutrinos with the energy density of photons, like this, where the factor 7 over 8 comes because they follow different statistics, and where the ratio of the temperatures I'm putting it here, because after the electron positron annihilation, you're not going to be the same. So from here, we can rewrite the energy density of radiation in this way, where the 3 comes because we know that there exist 3 active species of neutrinos. So now the effective number of neutrinos is just parametrizing this factor of 3. And this extra possible contribution into a parameter. So we're going to put it here, and we got the equation. So if this is going, if this factor is different than the one here, then this parameter is going to get a different number than 3. But in the instantaneous decoupling approximation, an effective is exactly 3 if we just account for neutrinos and photons of radiation. So this is another definition that you may find in the literature. And as I said, in the standard scenario, accounting only for neutrinos apart from photons, this parameter is going to take a value very close to 3. And this is the measured value by Planck last year. And you can see that it's close to 3. You see in the data of TTE and EMOS polarization, and also data from baryonic acoustic oscillations. So let's go back to these two processes. I said that the fact that they were completely separated was an approximation. So what actually happened there? The neutrino decoupling was not complete when the electron and positron annihilation started. So since the more energetic particles are the ones that are going to decouple later, we're going to find a deviation in the distribution function of neutrinos, especially in this energy, more energetic part. And also, since now neutrinos are interacting with electrons and positrons while they are annihilating, a part of the entropy of these particles are going to go to neutrinos. So the final temperature of photons is going to be smaller than in the instantaneous decoupling case. And this is going to modify an effective. So we need to follow the evolution of the distribution functions of neutrinos. But this is not the only source of deviation from this parameter from 3. We also need to take into account the fact that particles at this time are embedded in a cosmic plasma with a certain temperature, so they are not in vacuum. So we need to take into account that correction. And we could also think about different, some non-standard scenarios, like for example some neutrino-electron non-standard interactions, or very low reheating scenarios. And this has the peculiarity that among these 4 is the only one that allows for an effective smaller than 3. But since I'm going to speak about this in the last part of the talk, then I will focus just in the first one, which is the more important. So what is the effect that we find when we consider this, those two processes, the neutrino decoupling and the electron and positron annihilation, to be not completely independent? As I said, we are going to find a deviation in the distribution function of neutrinos, and the deviation is going to be larger. For larger energies, this is the co-moving momentum of neutrinos. And in the moment that we consider neutrinos to interact with, to be able to interact with electrons and positrons when they are annihilating, it is also important to take into account the fact that these particles oscillate in flavor and that neutrinos interact among themselves. And here you can see clearly as neutrino oscillations are important because the deviation from equilibrium is quite different. You account for them or not. So this would be the more complicated stuff, let's say, but I'm not going to go into details. But let's say just a few words of how should be computed this evolution. So we need to follow the evolution of the distribution functions of neutrinos. And since we need to account for the fact that these particles are interacting and they also oscillate in flavor, we need to go to the density matrix formally, in which the diagonal components give us the proportional numbers of neutrinos and the orthogonal components give us information about the oscillation. So we need to solve a set of integral differential coupled equations, the Boltzmann equations, accounting properly for the expansion of the universe, also for the fact that neutrinos oscillate, that they are oscillating in a medium, inside a medium, and that they are interacting with electrons, positrons, and among themselves. So as you can imagine, this is not going to be easy, computationally speaking. Specifically, this part here is the most complicated one to deal with. So in previous studies of this kind, the diagonal components, these collisional integrals, were approximated using some damping factors. What we did here is to relax that approximation and use the full collisional integrals also in the orthogonal components. So, for example, here you can find the statistical factor and the matrix element of the processes involved. This is complicated because even though you can reduce analytically 9 of the dimensions of this integral up to 2 dimensions, this remaining 2 dimensions integral need to be solved numerically. So we did that and we obtained this number. The effective number of neutrinos in this case is 3.044. But now you can wonder what happens if we do the same without including oscillations. And surprise, we find exactly the same up to this digit. This happens just because of a happy cancellation, let's say, of these deviations from equilibrium. Because you can clearly see here that the oscillations are important because there is a the deviation changes. I'm showing here the deviation from equilibrium of the energy density of neutrinos of the three flavors. You can see also here that they are different if we include or not include oscillations, but the differences cancel among them and in the end we obtain basically the same. But this is going to be important specifically for the second part of the talk, which is in the case that we go to very low reheating scenarios. And in this case, this part is based on a paper in which my advisor and I collaborated with some Italian guys from Naples and Ferrara. And let me put also a bit of a context here. So what is reheating? Because I'm going to go to very low reheating scenarios. Reheating is the name of the process by which the last radiation dominated epoch of the universe arises from the decay of a massive particle. And I'm going to go to very low reheating scenarios. That means that the reheating temperature, which is the temperature of the beginning of this last radiation dominated epoch, is going to be very low, very, very low, as low as a few MeVs. And since neutrinos decoupled when the universe had a temperature of order MeV, then they might not have enough time to thermalize if this happens. That means that the contribution to radiation is going to be smaller, so an effective is allowed to be smaller than 3, than the standard value, for smaller reheating temperatures. Here you can see the contribution of including oscillations, in this case, that you're going to see later that it is important, more important than it seems here. So, in our case, in our computation, we assume that the massive particles decay into relativistic particles but not neutrinos, so neutrinos were populated via the interaction with the charged leptons. This is the definition of the reheating temperature, where this is the Hubble parameter and this is the decay rate of the massive particle. And here I'm showing you the energy density of neutrinos divided by the energy density of photons in such a way that in the left part it gives me the effective number of neutrinos before electron-positron annihilation took place, which is seen here, this part. And in the right part, after this annihilation took place. So you can see that we really need to go to very low reheating temperatures because with a temperature as low as 15 MeV, neutrinos already follow the standard case. But for lower temperatures, they don't completely thermalize. So here I show why the oscillations can be really important in this case. When you go to these scenarios, the fact that neutrinos doesn't thermalize completely can affect both the CMB, the cosmic microwave background, and also the primordial nucleosynthesis. So for example, in the case of BPN, it is affected because a modification in the radiation content, the energy density of the universe, implies a modification in the Hubble expansion, and also a deviation from equilibrium in the this would imply a modification in the neutron to proton chemical equilibrium. And here I'm showing you for different reheating temperatures the helium mass fraction, which in this case this could go to the standard value, but for smaller reheating temperatures it deviates. And if we include or we do not include oscillations, not only the deviation is different, but also the tendency of the deviation can be different. So, as a summary of this part, let me remind you again that although a very low reheating scenarios, neutrinos might not be completely thermalized, so the contribution to radiation might not be as important as in the standard case. And in this case, as in the previous one, what we have done is compute a better computation of the neutrino production, relaxing some approximation in the kinetic equations, and also including free neutrino oscillations. And since this can modify the CMB and BPN, from the data from Planck in CMB and from BPN, you can put some lower bound for the reheating temperature. So from BPN, one would obtain this, and from CMB, the stronger bound was 0.47 MeV using the TT modes and a low polarization only. So what I would say that you can take home is that neutrino oscillations are usually very important, especially when computing cosmological parameters, and I showed you the case in the standard case, how they can affect the deviation from equilibrium of the energy density of neutrinos, and in the case of very low reheating scenarios, that they also can be very important.
Questions? For Pablo. I have a question before. In the plot that you show, I mean the table with the different differences that at the end give you the same number, this is valid for any oscillation, neutrino oscillation angles, or is just for the best fit?
For the best fit, but even though if you vary then the inside the ranges, you couldn't
get the same. So it's a kind of, but if you go beyond the ranges, you can get different effect, or it's something that is completely
if
independent
different
of
what?
Different ranges. If you start to play with the angles, mixing angles of neutrinos.
If you start to play with the mixing angles, but going out of the range, then yes, because you can.
Ah, okay. It's not the stuff that is just independent of the oscillation. That is, no matter which is the oscillation, it's gonna all the time give you the same number.
I don't think so. I mean, I haven't gone out of the range, but.
Mm-hmm. No, you're so.
I think you would obtain a different number if you go to different.
I mean, it would be the most reasonable, like, No, I was just curious if in that case it's just a cancellation of all the mixing angles, that at the end of the time you get the same for a reasonable reheating temperature.
May I comment here? I mean, because he is seeing no difference in the effective neutrino number, I don't know, it seems very obvious to me, maybe I'm wrong, but when you actually calculate the N effective, then you actually, what you care about is the energy density in neutrinos.
Mm-hmm.
And energy density in neutrinos doesn't depend on the basis, I mean, whether you are on the flavor basis or you are on the mass basis. So I will not expect any effect on effective number of neutrinos just because of oscillations. I mean, you tell me the total neutrino energy density as a sum of electron energy density or muon energy density or tau energy density, sum up all of them, that will be the same as nu1 energy density, neutrino energy density, nu3 energy density. And an effective is sensitive to only that.
Yeah,
so you put any...
Yeah, exactly. They interact differently with the electrons before. So because at that time, or a little bit before, you have also the before the electron-positron annihilation, then you are going to have that only electron neutrinos will interact with the plasma electron positron, and then still a little bit of the temperature. So in some sense, there is some effect. You expect some effect because of the oscillation.
Okay.
But roughly, it cannot be so large, I guess.
Yeah, and another thing, I mean, I wanted to ask you that suppose I accept that there is difference between this energy density between different species of neutrinos. As you saw that there is no observational consequences of this effect. I mean, suppose from...
But there is no observational consequences here, but if you go, for example, to something like this, you could find some deviation.
Mm.
Because if you include oscillations, or if you don't include oscillations, you find something different. In the case that you were in this kind of scenario.
This can be observed in a current day experiment, this plot, this reheating temperature by N effective?
Well, this plot, from here what you can obtain is the lower bound. But the lower bound for the reheating would be different if you include or you don't include oscillations. You cannot measure precisely what the reheating temperature.
Yeah, that's my problem. I mean, just as a case of deviation of energy density, I mean, we are not going to measure the energy density of neutrinos in, say, hundreds of years.
Yeah,
okay.
That's
good. So,
another question? There is one.
So the bound you have derived from the reheating temperature assumes that there is nothing else but neutrinos, right? Because if you have something else which is relativistic, blah, 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 then...
No, assume just neutrinos.
Only neutrinos.
Yes. Only neutrinos. Yes. Only neutrinos. In the standard case.
Okay.
So in principle, in the other plot that you have, that the very low reheating temperature is very big deviation with the tree can be filled with other unknown field that is there.
More room for extra contribution to radiation in this case.
But it has to thermalize faster, no? Because it has to be thermal very quickly, no? Already.
The other particles.
Yes.
Yeah. To write to tree, to see tree at the end of
to see the
effect. More questions? No. Another one. Is it possible to constrain the reheating temperature, but from, I mean, to give an upper bound with observation? I mean, just it's outside your talk, but just a curiosity.
An upper bound instead of a lower bound.
Yeah, I mean, with a lower bound, you can give it with the number, with the NF. But a higher bound, is it possible to...
I don't know.
Other type of throw? I don't know. No, just out of curiosity.
It's possible, but I don't know.
But there is no model independent assumption,
no,
the kind of
food.
Or maybe not so high, but to reduce it to 10 instead of 15.
Right.
I mean, just not to.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think so. But I have a question. I have two questions, or comments, but anymore. But when you put these numbers, these deltas, can you put the table that you show?
Yeah.
Did you look at what how it looks easily in mass eigenstate? Because at some point they are mass.
Yes, we did, but I don't remember the numbers.
Okay.
What we did, we followed not only the evolution of the, not this evolution in flavor, but also in the mass state.
I mean, because this is interesting, right? If the mass, because at some point we were close to measure the neutrino masses in cosmology, then the fact that maybe 70% or 30% they are the heaviest mass in the state, I mean, then you can play a little bit. It probably is not safe. And another thing about the range, you said you're moving the mixings and the parameters in the range of what the allowed regions.
In allowed region in the paper, do you remember exactly?
Any
paper, that's fine. Yes, inside the center value, so moving that range.
Typically when all the people they do these global fits and everything, they always assume unitarity and they fit the parameters, right? And a question that is there is if you can put bounds or not, how unitary is this? Maybe you can play this game here and try to check unitarity. That will probably change the effect.
Yes.
But there's some room on that. There's a paper for... Who is this guy? Steve Park has a paper like saying, oh, what happens if I don't assume unitarity and I use just neutrino data? And everything goes away.
We try to do that also.
Yeah, but here it should be some bound. Coming from the
NFL,
I guess.
And these deltas are deviation with respect to what? Like, what is your standard energy distribution? This delta, this percentage you are quoting.
So in the case that you assume equilibrium distribution function for neutrinos, you know that they are relativistic, you compute the energy density, and then you, from this deviation, you can compute the difference in the energy density of the different flavors.
Is there other question? So if not, I guess we thank Pablo.